$10 million heist, $67 million worth of jewelry reportedly stolen from the London home of a Formula One racing heiress. Magaruli is there in London.
Burglars seem to have used black taxi to make their getaway harder to trace.
Pounds worth of jewelry reportedly stolen. Quite a heist.
She's a model, TV host, and heiress worth hundreds of millions of dollars. But this morning, Tamara Eccleston's left shaken after a reported $67 million.
This here is known as Billionaire's Row, one of the most exclusive neighborhoods in the whole country. Tamara Eccleston's house, more than 50 rooms. Now, please say.
To Lapland in December, which is something we had done before with our daughter Sophia. It's one of like the highlights for us as a family. It's a beautiful trip, it's really magical. When we landed in Lapland, everything was fine. We were so excited. I was taking photos at the airport. There was loads of snow. It just was such a magical start. And I think we got quite an early night because Fifi had had school in the day, and then we traveled and a big day the next day. So after our dinner and put like Christmas pajamas on, we're really in like the festive mood. And then we went to sleep.
A security guy woke me up and said, you need to call John. And I remember my immediate thought being, shit, who's died? You know, because when you're woken up in the middle of the night and told to call someone, you obviously know it's going to be bad news. So I called John, and John said, I need to tell you something, buddy, and you're not going to like it. I said, yeah, just tell me, you know, spit it out.
And I said, I need you to listen to me. Someone has broken into the property, and I'm trying to get to the bottom of what's happened. And his reaction to me was, which property? And I said, mate, it's your house.
And I at that point remember thinking, oh, that's okay then, you know, because they must have caught them, or they wouldn't have got everything, because everything is locked away. But it gradually dawned on me in that conversation that actually they had been successful and they had been able to take quite a lot. Spend an hour in the house. They go into every single room on every single floor. Every single room is locked, so they use a crowbar to open every single door.
They had been in my dressing room, and my dressing room has a door which is like a panic room, and it's always locked when we travel, and you basically couldn't break into it if it had been locked properly, but it hadn't been locked properly by security that night. So once they were into that dressing room / panic room, they were able to take everything.
We both know
it was a lifetime's worth of jewelry. It was every piece of jewelry and every watch that she'd ever acquired since she was a kid.
Lots of things that were taken are basically irreplaceable to me because they have so much sentimental value. Bracelets that Jay had got me when I gave birth to Sophia. One of them had her name and diamonds on it, which he gave to me in the hospital the day that she was born. There were diamond earrings that were my mom's that she gave to me when I was in my 20s. Those are the things that I guess kind of hurt the most because they are memories of like the most special days of my life.
In terms of the total amount that was stolen, there was something like 450 different items. All of the jewelry and the watches that were stolen was all excluded in the insurance policy. The total monetary value of everything that was stolen was, I think, just over 20 million. After they've been in there an hour, after they have ransacked every single room, the security guy hears a noise in the house and he goes off to investigate. He doesn't raise an alarm, he doesn't arm himself with a weapon, he doesn't do anything, he just goes off to investigate. He continues to go upstairs where he runs into the three intruders. He apparently chases them downstairs. At some point, there's a fire extinguisher thrown at him that misses. And all three of the intruders are able to escape with the bags, and off into the night they go.
Thieves have reportedly stolen £50 million worth of jewellery from the home of Tamara Eccleston in London. Tamara Eccleston had apparently just left the country for Christmas when the burglars raided her home.
On one of London's most secure roads, alongside a number of embassies, the house has a 24-hour security team and a CCTV.
Suspects, three men making their way through the home's 57 rooms, cracking at least two safes before being discovered by on-site security. By the time the police were even called, the suspects were gone.
My name is Thomas McIntosh, and I'm a journalist with BBC London. I usually do day-to-day reporting, tube strikes, protests, murder trials, that kind of thing. But I'm always on the lookout for something bigger, something to really get my teeth into. When I first started looking into this story, I gradually became obsessed with it. How did the thieves pull this off? And where were the jewels? Nobody knew who was responsible. But the media were focused on one woman who was accused of wearing stolen diamonds, Maria Mester.
Mi chiamo Maria Mester, nata in Romania. In valore di 50 milioni di pound, che alla fine è risultato 26 o 23 perché non si sa mai la verità. Ecco, vuoi vedere questo? Puoi guardare, che viviamo noi qua. Ah! Ecco, Louis Vuitton. E questo è mio. A me mi piace la roba con i disegni, Mickey Mouse. È la roba che mi piace. Ecco. Ecco, Gucci. Non è da Tamara, è mio.
Maria Mester uploaded a photo to Facebook, which appeared to show her wearing one of Tamara Eccleston's stolen necklaces.
Jay showed me a photo of a lady, if you could call her that, wearing a necklace that Jay had bought for me for my birthday 1 year. It was like a very distinctive piece because it was rainbow colored diamonds. It just makes it feel very, very real, actually seeing something that belongs to you on someone else and just not being able to get it even back, or not even getting closer to getting it back. It just seems really unfair and wrong.
Ti piace che bella donna ero là? E adesso sono un rottame. No, non ho rubato nessuno a rubare i gioielli né a trasportarli di Tamara Eccleston, perché il lavoro di una escort è per ricevere che i gioielli, che le vacanze, che i regali, che i vestiti, che cash, qualsiasi cosa. Vukovic l'ho conosciuto in anni passati, 2016, 2013, da 13 a 16. L'ho conosciuto in un locale a Milano che si chiamava Porta d'Oro, non hai. E lui per me è stata una gallina con le ove di oro, come tutti gli altri clienti generosi. Io non vedevo niente di sbagliato in quello scemo. Sì, da Vukovic mi ha fatto un regalo per il mio compleanno, tutto qua. Lui mi pagava come escort per i miei servizi, niente altro. No, non sapevo che nessuno sono rubati. Sì, che ne sapevo io che la, è la collana di Tamara Eccleston.
Who is the man who gave Maria Mester this jewelry? Who is Vukovic? When we took on this investigation, I had a conversation with my detective inspector. We both looked at each other and said, this isn't going to be a quick win.
Just an emo day stuff collector. Things come to the brain.
There was no lines of inquiry that led us anywhere. The police were genuinely stumped at first. They had no faces, no names, nothing. They assumed the suspects had fled the country. The Ecclestons might never get their jewelry back. It took them a few weeks to get their first break in the case. So following examination of CCTV material, we were able to identify that the gang had flagged down a London black taxi to escape from the scene. This gang of jewel thieves were demonstrating quite sophisticated tradecraft. They were using anonymous London black taxis. They wasn't booking them, they were flagging them down. They knew they could anonymize themselves quite effectively, and that's what they did. That London black taxi was traced to South East London and St Mary's Cray. Our first break, boom, we got something. We identified a taxi driver had dropped the gang off. The only thing he could remember is a particular landmark, and that was a red bricked bridge. This was the only bridge that we could find that matched the description of what he told us. Now, thankfully, a CCTV camera just there identified three figures walking around the corner. And that's how we identified them to be in this hotel. We're in room 203. The room the gang used as their base. It's a location that we call the slaughter. They took the diamonds and jewels and cash and divvied it up. We are standing in a room where £26 million worth of stolen jewellery and cash was sitting. One of the suspects had used his ID card to check into the hotel. But that wasn't the only piece of evidence he'd left behind.
My name's Alexandra Jones, and I've spent a long time investigating this story. The hotel gave the suspect a phone number, which was the emergency line to call if he needed anything late at night. And instead of just laying low, he does a typical creepy guy thing and sends a dick pic to this iPhone. The receptionist saw it, blocked him, and saved his number under weirdo in the phone.
From that dick pic and the ID card, the police had their first name in the investigation. Yugoslav Jovanovic.
The only downfall for Yugoslav Jovanovic is that he had given us his phone number to see where he had been and what he had been doing. But more importantly, who was he talking to?
The police were now on the hunt for the identities of the rest of the suspects.
The CCTV is really what broke this investigation completely wide open. Inquiries undertaken around capturing this vital CCTV evidence linked us back to Victoria Station. It's at Victoria Station you can see the suspects for the first time buying some coffees or tea at the small outlets of Patisserie Valerie.
You can see Jovanovic at Patisserie Valerie. He's part of a group of four. But there were only three men who were seen running across the back garden in Tamara Eccleston's property. The group of suspects just got bigger.
One of the interesting things about this group is that on the one hand, you've got this criminal gang who've masterminded a series of well-thought-out burglaries. And on the other hand, you've got this group of people who are just stopping off to grab a coffee at Patisserie Valerie, stealing some chewing gum on the way to do the burglary.
Who are the other three suspects? The detectives can't identify them from the footage. But closer inspection of the CCTV reveals a fifth person, although his face is hidden from the Patisserie Valerie camera.
So at Victoria Station, there's probably hundreds of thousands of people that use those barriers a day, and that'd be millions a week. So it was really about narrowing down these particular barriers over a short time frame to then say who's touched in, who's touched out, and how have they done that. From there, we've got four cards being used that, although unregistered and prepaid to some description, were showing a slight pattern of usage. But the real breakthrough came when one of the associates had used his mobile phone linked to a bank card to pay at the barrier.
That phone belonged to this man, seen here walking across the station.
We were confident is what we now know to be a male Bogdan Sebastiu.
So everyone in this group used prepaid Oyster cards so that they couldn't be tracked. Everyone apart from Sebastiu. Sebastiu was an interesting character. He was Maria Mester's son.
Sebastiu told police he had nothing to do with the burglaries. He was in London visiting his mother.
Bogdan for me in my life. No Bogdan, no nothing for me. For me, Bogdan, my God.
Police didn't think Sebastiu was a burglar. They suspected him of being part of the alleged support cast, providing logistics.
His involvement was booking flights, paying for taxis, arranging accommodation.
It wasn't clear whether Sebastiu knew about the burglars, but either way, he had helped the burglars. Now the police have two foreign nationals, Jovanovic and Sebastiu, and it boosts their theory that they've come into the UK with one thing on their mind, to make a lot of money.
Well, what are the chances of you just coming to London or being in London committing one such offence? So it's at that stage that we tasked our intelligence department to really have a look across London to look at similar offences.
some really high-profile homes were being targeted.
We narrowed it down to approximately 12 to 15 offences.
So we're talking musicians, models, actors. This is the biggest series of domestic burglaries in UK history. They really thought they'd gotten away with it.
Suddenly, this wasn't just about the Eccleston. It was a massive, city-wide investigation.
We had a breakthrough at a particular premises in Knightsbridge. So this address in Knightsbridge was the London residence of the deceased Leicester City Football Club owner. Following his death, sadly, from a helicopter crash, the family had dedicated this space as a shrine. Everything was exactly as the day it was when he left that premises.
They broke in through a front patio door and they trashed the place. They smashed open a safe containing 400,000 euros in cash. They took 7 Patek Philippe watches. They even opened a 500-pound bottle of vintage Cristal champagne. The total amount stolen from Vishai C. Watanaprapar's home was valued at around £1 million. But the burglars had made another mistake. Yugoslav Jovanovic was caught on CCTV ringing a doorbell on the night of the burglary. For now, they'd gotten away with it, and it was time to celebrate.
So what the suspects have then done the next evening after this burglary is they've gone to Zuma restaurant in Knightsbridge, which I believe is a Japanese restaurant where they've spent just short of £800. There was an itemised bill for that, including pretty much what appeared to be everything on the menu and drinks accordingly.
£100 in Zuma is maybe not that hard. This is the kind of place you would go and pay more than £10 for a bowl of edamame beans.
So at this stage, police are poring over the unsolved burglaries list. What else have these guys done?
So when we had identified the third in a sequence of offences, again, this was something we were able to do via CCTV footage that the residents of that particular premises had. This is the property of Frank and Christine Lampard.
The CCTV on the Lampard's home clearly shows Yugoslav Jovanovic again leading the burglars into the property.
Frank and Christine Lampard were at Winter Wonderland when they actually got burgled. But the burglars managed to trigger a silent alarm and the police were alerted and actually kind of disturbed them mid-burglary. Despite that, they managed to get away with £60,000 worth of watches and cufflinks from Frank Lampard.
In total, the burglars managed to get away with around £26 million worth of stolen watches, cash, jewellery and cufflinks.
I mean, they got 60,000 from the first house, a million from the second, and 25 million from the third house. It's amazing.
They had hit London for 10 days and walked away as multi-millionaires. The jewels might be gone. Police discovered that Emil Bogdan Savastru had returned to London. And it wasn't just Savastru who was of interest. It was also his mother, Maria Mester.
On the 17th of December 2019, we were able to identify that Maria Mester had gone to Harrods and was spending approximately £3,000 on high-value luxury items, the brands of Louis Vuitton, Hermes. we believe that she was spending the proceeds of the burglaries themselves.
Mester said that her money came from Vukovic.
Quello che mi dava per i servizi sessuali, quelli avevo il conto perché sapevo, ma mi dava 500, 1000, 2000 per andare in giro a fare il shopping, perché lui mi diceva che c'ha da fare, che va a destra, va a sinistra, e io in giro per Londra per fare shopping. Come di solito in tutta la mia vita.
Sebastian and his mother are now actively being traced by the police.
We followed Emil Sebastiu to London Heathrow Airport. He had booked a one-way ticket to Japan. We knew he was about to leave the country and we wasn't prepared to allow that to take place. We had to ensure that any mobile phone device Emil Bogdan Sebastiu was using was open and not locked. My colleague, DI Jim Simmons, and myself effectively had to tackle him to the ground to ensure that our objective of having his phone open was achieved. The wristwatch he was wearing belonged to the late Leicester City chairman that had been stolen on the 10th of December. The bag he was carrying belonged to Jay Rutland. Even within that bag, 6 weeks after the burglaries had been committed, we even found one small diamond still inside.
Sebastiu told police he thought he was helping his mother's friends and he had no idea that heists were being carried out across London.
Whilst dealing with ML Sebastiu at Heathrow Airport, I received a call telling me that in 90 minutes, Maria Mester was about to land at London Stansted Airport following a flight from Italy.
90 minutes later, Maria Mester was arrested.
She was caught at Stansted Airport wearing Tamara Eccleston's earrings.
Ma gli orecchini io li ho ricevuti perché visto che sono nata il secondo giorno di Natale, 26 di dicembre, me li ha regalati come regalo di mio compleanno.
It wasn't possible to be certain they were the exact same earrings, but the jewelry designer who made them said that only 3 pairs had ever been made, and one of them had been sold to Tamara Eccleston.
That bitch was wearing my jewellery.
The police believed they had finally recovered some of the stolen jewels. But millions of pounds worth of diamonds, watches and necklaces remained unaccounted for. What had happened to them? By now, police circulated images of the suspects with Europol. Eventually, they came back with matches from authorities in Italy. One was Alessandro Donati, a small-time burglar from Milan. The second, Alessandro Maltese, also from Milan, but with a clean record. The third was Yugoslav Jovanovic, 23 years old, but already known to the Italian authorities. And the last man was Daniel Vukovic.
I'm not at liberty to say who that is.
The police didn't want to talk about Vukovic, so I started digging. In 2009, Vukovic was linked to other high-profile celebrity burglaries in Milan. Victims included Arsenal legend and French international footballer Patrick Vieira. So who is Vukovic? The hunt for the diamonds and the thieves moves to Italy. This is Monte Bisbino. It's an area on the outskirts of Milan, well known for criminal activity. Police had warned us it was a no-go zone. One theory is that Tamara Eccleston's diamonds passed through here.
Mi chiamo Francesco Giustolisi e sono un vicequestore aggiunto della Polizia di Stato. Le l'esecuzione del mandato d'arresto europeo da parte della polizia italiana nei confronti delle persone indagate dalla polizia inglese è avvenuto nel mese di luglio. In particolare, il giorno dell'esecuzione, Alessandro Maltese è stato arrestato dai colleghi della squadra mobile di Varese, che erano competenti territorialmente perché si trovava in provincia di Varese. Donati Alessandro è stato individuato da personale della squadra mobile di Milano nella sua abitazione in provincia di Milano. Contestualmente, lo stesso giorno è stato cercato anche Jovanovic, Jugoslav, presso il campo nomadi di Monte Pisbino, solo che ovviamente Jugoslav Jovanovic quel giorno al campo nomadi non c'era.
There was one man, Francesco Giustolisi, did not mention.
Just to be clear, do you have any police records on Fukovic?
No, non abbiamo.
The police have hit another brick wall. Two of the suspects are in custody, but the other two can't be found, Jovanovic and Vukovic. The police turn their attention to the alleged support team. Jovanovic's phone records show that he had texted a man called Soren Markovici, also known as the Professor.
The people call me professor because when I do the thing like one professional guy. My name is Sori Markovic. I work in Romanian security for one guy. I grew up here on this neighborhood.
I'm wearing one anorak from Off-White, T-shirt from Dolce Gabbana, pants Dolce Gabbana, shoe Dolce Gabbana. The glasses from Dita, the cap from Icon, T Square, 5,000-6,000 pounds. Only the clothes for today. I like watches from Cartier. The watch what I have today is 1,400 pounds. I have good car, good place for live. My money never ends. This is money never ends. I was accused for conspiracy to burglary, high-profile people from UK, people from high society class. I am innocent, and I was innocent, and the police, you know, I was innocent from the beginning.
Markovici was a kind of del boy, wheeler-dealer character, very flashy, lot of aftershave. Kind of everyone's pal until he wasn't.
The night before the raid on Vishai C. Watanakapar's home, Soren Markovici drove the suspects from their hotel to West London and back. The following day, Jovanovic texted Markovici with the words Canelo d'Italio. The police believed this meant cutting torch or blowtorch.
Yes, I received one message. Yes, I received one message in my phone. I received one message. Be careful, people. In Italian, only one word. Canelo Taglio. Canelo Taglio, in Italian, if we talk in English, it's cutting torch. But Anello Taglio, it's lamp cutting. Cutting lamp, you know. And when I receive this name, I think I speak the truth. I think the people invite me to lamp.
Markovici said he thought he was being asked to lunch, not being asked to provide a blowtorch. Markovici had agreed to do some more driving, but there was a dispute over pay.
And I say, Maria, say to the guy, I don't come today.
I'm sorry the people don't pay me yesterday night. And I don't talk never anymore with these people.
You can tell me if you recognize the man in this picture. That would be great.
Yes. No. No, I don't recognize.
We knew that Soren was driving the gang around London. What we don't know is, what did Soren Markovic know about what they were doing? That in Soren Markovic's knowledge, he's always maintained he didn't know what they were doing.
Three of the alleged support team are now under arrest. The net is closing in on the final suspect, Alexandru Stan. The burglars came to his house after the Lampard burglary.
Yeah, put me a little bit of sugar, please, because my life is not so sweet. Everything, all the evidence against me show that I couldn't be involved. My name is Alexandru Stan. I was born in Romania. I am 50 years old. One of my best friends called me on Saturday. It was 31-30 November, I don't know. So before first, and asked me if I can come with him next day because he's gonna meet with two people. Send him for one of his best friends from Italy, try to settle here. So then we come to this restaurant and I think we were sitting somewhere here.
The two men were Vukovic and Jovanovic. After raiding the Lampard's home, they took a cab straight to Alexandru Stan's home in Harrow.
They come to my place and one of them, the youngest one, I think Hugo, his jacket was waved apart like somebody grabbed him, you know? It was a little bit like somebody broke him. The other one, older one, was have a little cut here. And that's what happened. We have a fight. So he said, we don't want our girls, you know, our wives to show us like this. So I give them a pair of trousers. I never crossed my mind that something can be dodgy.
Alexandru Stan called the burglars a taxi to St. Mary Cray. And that was the last time he saw them.
Just can I show you a picture, Alex? And I just want you to tell me if you know who it is.
Could be. He could be the other one. Could be Vukovic.
Alexandru Stan had a role, but we knew his role was a second-tier player, assisting them with effectively logistics, change of clothing, organising onward travel, taxi travel to St. Mary's Cray.
The alleged support team were now ready for trial. But as the trial approaches, police have another unexpected breakthrough. Jovanovic. He's been arrested at an apartment in the seaside town of Santa Maranella.
It was a huge moment in the investigation that Yugoslav Jovanovic, Alessandro Donate, Alessandro Maltese had been successfully apprehended.
But the detectives have a problem. There is no time to try the main suspects alongside the alleged support team.
The burglars hadn't even come back to the UK. Therefore, the people facing trial had to have their trial at the earliest opportunity. But it is unusual for what we call, in this case, the support team, going on trial before the actual main burglars. I have to work closely with my lawyer counterpart from the Complex Case Unit of the Crown Prosecution Service.
And in this case, the lawyer was Andrew Haddock.
Yes, well, I mean, I got on perfectly professionally with the officers. Now, there are times when we disagree about things, but that is hardly surprising. In fact, that's part of our function, actually, to test each other. We tried four people as a support team that provided accommodation, finances, etc., for the burglars. The burglars were not available to be in this country at that stage. But their trial commenced in November 2020. The height of COVID, it was actually quite a logistical nightmare in many respects. We had to use two courtrooms linked electronically. And the jury were all in Perspex boxes, essentially, and it required a lot of juggling.
I sat in one of those Perspex boxes, watching the trial. From the beginning, it was clear this was going to be challenging. One of the jurors was dismissed midway through the trial. There was a two-week break for Christmas, not to mention all the difficulties with COVID. By the end of all this, I just simply didn't have a clue which way these verdicts were going to go.
Those four defendants were found not guilty by the jury at the end of the day of conspiracy to burgle as the support team.
The alleged support team had successfully convinced the jury that they had helped the burglars without knowing anything about the burglars themselves.
The nail in the coffin of that case is when one of the jurors got COVID the day or the day after they'd been sent out for deliberation, which meant that it then got postponed for 2 weeks. And then I think on the first day back, not guilty.
I don't think it was COVID was a question of management, and it was quite difficult to manage the case because you had to have two courtrooms, everything takes much longer, and so therefore, it's more difficult.
It was certainly a disadvantage of having the trial of the what we call the support team before that of the main burglars.
We don't have the answers that we really do want. And it's just frustrating that we don't know.
The acquittals was certainly disappointing. However, they were acquitted by a jury. We have to accept that decision.
Tutto questo castigo perché conoscevo quelle persone, ho frequentato le persone sbagliate, ma non mio figlio. Perché ho scelto questa vita, ma non ho mai fatto del male a nessuno. Ma sono innocente 100% su questi furti, perché la polizia non ha mai dimostrato la mia innocenza, né quella di mio figlio, perché hanno portato in tribunale solo quello che hanno voluto loro.
After I was released, I lost everything. My family, my place where to live. I was homeless for 1.5 months. In a matter of seconds, my life was thrown upside down and destroyed.
The power of God is without measure. God saved me and this jury.
This is pretty much a worst-case scenario for the police. The alleged support cast have now been acquitted. Now police have to make a case against the three men they have in custody, who they believe to be the primary suspects in these burglaries. At this point, the odds are stacked against them. Alessandro Maltese and Alessandro Donati also pleaded guilty Can you imagine the relief? Finally, some vindication for the detectives.
Examined in excess of 2,000 hours of CCTV footage, hundreds of lines of inquiries, one of which resulted in officers having to contact in excess of 1,000 London black taxi drivers to identify potential witnesses. This was one of many breakthroughs in this painstaking investigation.
A gang of jewellery thieves who stole £26 million worth of luxury goods in raids targeting celebrities such as Frank Lampard and Tamara Eccleston have been jailed this afternoon. Yugoslav Jovanovic, Alessandro Molteni.
Well, Mr. Jovanovic received 9 years imprisonment for conspiracy to burgle and 2 years consecutive, so on top of that, for the conspiracy to money launder. That makes a total of 11 years for him. And then Mr. Molteser and Mr. Donati both received for the conspiracy to burgle 8 years and 9 months imprisonment each.
If you could stand up in that courtroom and face them, what would you say to them?
That they are disgusting. I just find it sickening that people are so such low lives. Having seen their faces, it's kind of haunting in a way. They look fucking beyond. Knowing that that kind of person has been roaming around your house and helping themselves freely to my most treasured, valuable possessions, it's just a horrible feeling. I feel like I can't get those faces now out of my mind.
When the three were finally sentenced, it was relief. It was the end of a long, long road. But we're satisfied and we're happy with the results that we got. They didn't think they were going to get caught because they had come to the UK with one intention, to steal as much money as they could. They had no idea that one of the best law enforcement agencies in the Metropolitan Police were going to be hunting them down.
Thank you for your time.
The case was closed. The police hadn't found Tamara Eccleston's diamonds, but they had put the main suspects behind bars, and they were ready to move on. I wanted to move on too, but I couldn't get this story out of my mind. Time to move on.